Good afternoon and Merry Christmas to you. Welcome to our Christmas Eve service, where this afternoon we get to focus on the love that God has shown us in our lives by sending us that gift of His Son, our Savior, Jesus. We're going to begin our service by singing hymn 35, The Printed Verses. Please stand. As we gather this day, the setting, the church, is peaceful.
We have
as we listen to the word this afternoon, God will offer us His unconditional love. As we hear God's word and sing His praises, we'll be reminded of the gift of forgiveness Jesus came to win for us and give to us. And so we gather in this peaceful setting to experience and rejoice in the peace, spiritual peace, that Jesus earned for each of us. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light, your Son, our Savior, Jesus. Grant that as we have come to know that true light on earth, we may also see him in all his glory in the life to come. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. So we'll sing hymn 11. Our first lesson for this Christmas Eve service is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. For those living in the land of the shadow of death, the light has dawned. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you like the joy at harvest time, like the celebration when people divide the plunder. For you have shattered the yoke that burdened them. You have broken the bar on their shoulders and the rod of their oppressor, as you did in the day of Midian. Every boot that marched in battle and the garments rolled in blood will be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born. To us a son is given. The authority to rule will rest on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no limit to his authority and no end to the peace he brings. He will rule on David's throne and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from now on into eternity. The zeal of the Lord of armies will accomplish this. That is the word of our Savior. We'll continue with hymn 60, singing all three verses. Our second reading is from 1 John, and please notice that it is a responsive reading. This is how God's love for us was revealed. God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we may live through him. Dear friends, if God loved us so much, we also should love one another. We'll continue with hymn 67. Gospel lesson from Luke 2. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governing Syria. And everyone went to register, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the town of Nazareth into Judea to the town of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was from the house and family line of David. He went to be registered with Mary, his wife, who was pledged to him in marriage and was expecting a child. And so it was that while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. They were in the same country, shepherds staying out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior was born for you. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude from the heavenly army praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace, goodwill toward mankind." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Now, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they told others the message they had been told about this child. And all who heard it were amazed by what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. The Gospel of our Savior. We'll continue by singing hymn 707. Christmas Eve. And I think you can feel a little bit of the excitement. You can feel a little bit of the anticipation. You can feel it because family is going to be getting together. Friends are going to be getting together to enjoy each other's company and have, Lord willing, a wonderful time. You can see the excitement in the children's eyes because they know that either tonight or tomorrow they get to open presents. And if your children are like mine, they have been asking all day, can we open presents? The anticipation, the excitement, it is here. And it is wonderful, and I pray that you enjoy time with your families, and I pray that you get every kind of Christmas gift that you have ever wanted. But as you enjoy your evening in tomorrow, I pray that for just a moment, you remember what your loving Father in heaven has done for you. That you, for just a moment, take time like Mary did and treasure up the wonderful news of Jesus Christ and what he came to do. We read just two verses from Isaiah 9. For you have shattered the yoke that burdened them. You have broken the bar on their shoulders and the rod of their oppressor, as you did in the day of Midian. Every boot that marched in battle and the garments rolled in blood will be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. Not really a good Christmas text, unless we fully understand what the Lord was having Isaiah write. The Lord was having Isaiah write what Jesus Christ, who is going to be born some 700 years later, was going to do. And what Isaiah does is, as any good presenter of information does, he speaks to the people in a way that they can understand and relate to very well. And what the people in Isaiah's day could relate to very well was war. They lived in a very tumultuous time where war was an everyday occurrence, where life was being taken by sword or spear daily. They understood and could relate to war and its effects. And in war, you have two people. You have the winners, and you have the losers. And what would happen in the days of Isaiah in biblical days is one of two things. The winners, the victors, the stronger nation would come in, and they could either just completely annihilate that nation, that country that they defeated, or they could place a heavy yoke, a heavy burden on those losers' shoulders and demand money, food, or slaves, or whatever. And so that's the picture Isaiah uses to describe what Jesus was going to do. He uses the picture of a conquering nation putting a heavy yoke, a heavy burden on people, the rod of the oppressors that beats you down into submission. And what Jesus would do would be to free the people from that heavy yoke of burden. What Jesus would do would shatter the rod of the oppressors. But what Isaiah makes very clear throughout the rest of these verses is that Jesus was not coming to free the Israelites from the Assyrians or from the Babylonians or from the Persians. What Isaiah makes clear is that Jesus was going to lift the heavy yoke of sin off of his people. That Jesus was going to come and lift that rod of the oppressor of death in Satan off of their back so they wouldn't have to bear it anymore. That was what Jesus was going to do for them. And that was the very relatable picture that Isaiah's hearers at the time could understand very well. Jesus came to be a liberator. He came to be a releaser of suffering in misery, a remover of sin. And that is something that we this evening will celebrate. We will celebrate what our Savior Jesus has done for us. Because you and I were under and are under that heavy yoke of sin. You and I are under that rod of the oppressor of Satan in death. Your conscience confirms it. When you do something wrong, it speaks to you and makes you feel bad, guilty, shameful. And you know your sins, whether they are bold and beautiful or whether they are small and insignificant. Whether it's just the thoughts of greed and lust, whether it's the actual actions of violence against others you don't really like, or just the thoughts of, oh, I wish they would drop dead. Or whether it's the sinful perversions that our minds can come up with. Or whether it's just simply failing to do as God instructs us and pray to Him in our time of need, pray to Him in our time of fear and concern. Because He promises to hear and answer in a way that is best for you. You yourself know what sins you struggle with. You yourself know what sins eat you up the most. We probably see it a lot during the holidays, indifference towards God's word. Focusing on what is not important, neglecting what is truly important. Hearing that wonderful, saving message of our Savior. Our sins are clear to us, sometimes made even clearer by others. And for the sins, you know well what God says. It is wrath. It is eternal punishment that He demands be put on us for what we have done. You are responsible for your own actions, your own thoughts, and your own words. And what's great, we come here with that yoke of burden, that yoke of sin on us. We come here under that heavy rod of our oppressor as Satan just likes to keep reminding us how unworthy we are of God and His love. And what does God do for you? for to us a child is born. To us a son is given. There is what God did for you. He said that yoke that's upon you, that burden that is on you, that rod of the oppressor that is on you, here is how I am going to solve that problem. A child. My child. My son. I am going to give to you. My child, Jesus, whose birth we look forward to celebrating tomorrow. My child, Jesus, who is going to be born in Bethlehem. My child, Jesus, if you read the book of Isaiah, you will see clearly what he is going to do. What is it that Jesus will do? For you have shattered the yoke that burdened them. You, Jesus, have broken the bar on their shoulders in the rod of their oppressors. That is what that baby Jesus came to do. To unburden you. To free you. To remove those oppressors from you. And how did he do it? But now Christ reconciled you in his body of flesh through death. God sent you his son, Jesus, so that his son, Jesus, could die. So that his son, Jesus, could taste the flames of hell to set you free. To remove your sins from you, to liberate you from that heavy yoke that you cannot carry or remove on your own. Your Savior, Jesus, released you by his precious blood that was spilled on the cross, completely forgiving you your sins. And what did it do for you? In order to present you holy, blameless, and faultless before God. There's the result of the work of Jesus. You are faultless, blameless, and pure in the eyes of God because of that work of Christ. You will not taste the wrath of God. You will not experience his anger, but you will be welcomed with open arms by God himself and to heaven itself because of Jesus. Hear these verses from Isaiah 9. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The authority to rule will rest on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no limit to his authority and no end to the peace he brings. He will rule on David's throne and over his kingdom to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness from now on into eternity. The zeal of the Lord of armies will accomplish this. Who is that child that saved you? Isaiah describes him as the Almighty God. You can think of whatever picture of God you want to. Think of the Bible where you see example after example of his awesomeness. Creating the world, raising the dead, healing the sick, stopping nature, causing fire to come down from heaven, sending an angel the plague of death. to kill hundreds of thousands of people because they sinned. That mighty God is with you. That mighty, powerful, living Lord is beside you. And that mighty, powerful, living Lord is the Prince of Peace. He calms your fears. He takes away your sorrow. First and foremost, spiritually, the sins that eat you up inside, He says they're gone. Trust that word. They are gone. The sorrow and sadness and fear and worry that we experience in this world because everything is always out of our control. What does God say? I am the Prince of Peace. I will calm you. I will soothe you. Just for once, look and trust in me and understand this. Forever is how long my rule will last. The Lord of armies will accomplish that. So enjoy your family. Enjoy the friends. But remember that gift that God has given you this night. That child, the mighty Savior, Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please stand. As we'll continue with the responsive prayer found in the bulletin. O gracious and almighty Father, we praise you that you kept your ancient promises by sending your everlasting Son in human flesh. You sent Jesus as a lowly child to demonstrate your concern for all, the weak and lonely, the troubled and frightened, the timid and helpless. No one is overlooked by your ever-seeking eyes. No one is excluded from your upholding arms. No one is denied the comfort and help of your outstretched hand. You sent Jesus as the light of the world to drive out all darkness that would rob us of the full life that you intended for us. May the joy that will be for all people be our joy. May the peace on earth to all on whom his favor rests be our peace. May the treasure that Mary pondered in her heart be our treasure. And Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with Joni Rupp now as she mourns the passing of her mother. Comfort her with your love and assure her of a joyous reunion in heaven because of the gift of your Son, Jesus. And we'll join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This Christmas Eve, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and always give you his peace. Amen. Please be seated as we'll join in the last hymn.